In this segment, we're going to take an example of how we can solve a set of equations by using Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting. So we're given three equations, three unknowns, and we want to be able to use Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting to find out what the three unknowns are. So what we're going to do is we're going to write down these three equations, three unknowns, which are given the matrix form. We write the augmented matrix, which basically implies that in the augmented matrix, you write down your coefficient matrix, then you write your right-hand side vector right here. It makes the presentation clearer also, and we don't have to be concerned about any kind of confusion taking place when we show the operations which are done in the forward elimination steps. So there are two steps of Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting, forward elimination and back substitution. And one of the things which we got to understand is that Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting is exactly the same as naive Gaussian elimination method, except for the step which you have to take right before you conduct the forward elimination steps. So let's go and see what that means. So let's go and first talk about the forward elimination and see what the difference between the naive Gaussian elimination method and the Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting is. Of course, we have to understand that we'll be having two steps of forward elimination because we have n minus 1 steps. N is the number of equations we have. We have three equations. 3 minus 1 is 2. So we're going to have two steps of forward elimination. So this is what I was talking to you about, is that what the difference between Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting and naive Gaussian elimination method is, that you don't straight away start doing the elimination. What you have to do is you have to see that whether you need to switch any rows. Now, since we are at the step 1 of forward elimination, so what you do is you look at the first column. You look at the first column of the coefficient matrix. You take the absolute value of all the elements of the first column, and you're finding out that the maximum is 144, and that is existing in row 3, as you can see right here. So since we are at the first step of forward elimination and we're finding out the maximum element in the first column is in the third row, we're going to do a switch. We're going to switch row 3 with row 1 and row 1 with row 3. So that's the switch is going to take. Everything else is going to stay the same. So that's why you're finding out that this is becoming this row and this is becoming this row right here. So that was actually the third row which we had. This is the first row which we had. So we've done the switch based on the maximum element existing in the first column, the absolute value. After this, the first step of forward elimination will be exactly the same as naive Gaussian elimination method after you've done the switching process. So if you understand the forward elimination steps of naive Gaussian elimination method, you should now be able to understand this reasonably well. So in the first step of formulation, what we have to do is we have to make these two elements to be zero. And I have to use the first row to do that. Well, that means I can take 64 and I can divide it by 144. So 64 divided by 144 is 0.4444. And that's this number here. So I can take the first row, multiply it by 0.444, and I get this as my multiple of that first row. This is my second row. This is the second row. I'm going to take the multiple of the first row and put it right there, and I'm going to subtract the two rows. I'm going to get 0 here. This is not exactly 64, but it is close to 64 because the round of errors are getting 63.99, but I'll have to treat it as a 0 because that's the whole point about doing the process. So I'm going to replace my second row by what I obtained from subtracting the multiple of first row by the second row. And I have accomplished the fact that I got a 0 here. This is not the end of the first step of formulation because I still got to make this to be 0. How do I go about doing that? That's as follows. I need to make this to be 0 and I have to use the first row to do that. So I'm going to take 25, I'm going to divide it by 144. And I'm going to get 0.1736. So I'm going to take the first row, multiply it with 0.1736, and I'm going to get 25 right here, so that I can, when I subtract it, I'll get 0. So this is the multiple of the first row which I'm getting. This here is my third row of the augmented matrix. I'm going to subtract the multiple of the first row, and I'll get the 0 which I was looking for. and whatever is the resulting row, I'm going to replace the third row by that. And you can already see that I got the zero here, I got the zero here, and I've accomplished what I had to accomplish by the first step of forward elimination. Let's go and see what we need to do now for the second step of forward elimination. Again, before you start conducting the same kind of procedure as you did for the Gaussian elimination method, again you have to find out these absolute values. Now, since I am at step 2, I need to look at second row, second column, third row, second column. So you basically have to look at all the column elements in the second row and below. And you have to do the same thing, see that where the maximum occurs. So here you're finding out that the absolute value is 2.667, absolute value is 2.917. The absolute value, which is the largest, is 2.917, exists in row 3. So what that means is that the row 3 has to be switched with row 2, because this number, absolute value, is bigger than this number here. So that's why you're finding out this goes right here and this one is going right here. So that's a switch which you are seeing here. This used to be the third row, now it's the second row. This used to be the second row, and now it's the third row. So after we've done the switching, now the steps of forward elimination are exactly the same as the Gaussian elimination of partial pivoting. I need to make everything which is below the second row in the second column to be zero, which leaves us with this element here. And I have to use my second row to do that. So the element which I'll have is 2.667 divided by 2.917 gives me 0.9143. So this will become my multiple of the second row. I take the multiple of the second row, and this is what I get. And I'm going to take my third row. Subtract this, and what's going to happen is I'm going to get a zero right here, because that's what I wanted to accomplish in the first place. Now I'm going to replace my third row by what I accomplished by subtracting the multiple of the second row from the third row. And this is what I'm going to get. And you can very well see that in the coefficient matrix, this is the coefficient matrix, I'm getting an upper triangular matrix, because this element is zero, this element is zero, this element is zero. So that's the end of the all the forward elimination steps of Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting, because I have been able to reduce my coefficient matrix into an upper triangular matrix. So let's go and conduct the back substitution steps. Again, I will remind you that the back substitution steps are exactly the same as Gaussian elimination method. So let's go and see how that is done. I'm going to take the augmented matrix which I wrote, I'm going to rewrite it again in the matrix form so that we'll have a clear understanding of how we are doing the back substitution. So in the back substitution, the reason why it's called back substitution is because we start from the last equation. So if you look at the last equation, it is this multiplied by these three elements is equal to this. Since we have zero here and zero here, we get only one unknown, one equation. And that turns out with the value of a sub 3. Now let's go and see how we're going to conduct the next step of back substitution. The next step of back substitution again will be conducted by looking at this being multiplied by this vector here is equal to 58.33. So that's my second equation right here. And again, you might think that hey, there are two unknowns now, because a sub 2 is an unknown, a sub 3 is an unknown, but a sub 3 was just found from the previous step. So I'm going to move that to the right hand side and write down my equation for a sub 2. Since a sub 3 is 1.15, I can substitute that in and get my value of a sub 2 right there, which is 19.67. Same thing is going to happen now. I'm going to now look at the first equation, which is this multiplied by this unknown vector equal to 279.2. That is this equation right here. Now again, here you might think that there are three unknowns, a sub 1, a sub 2, a sub 3, but actually there's only one unknown, which is a sub 1, because a sub 2 and a sub 3 are already known to us from the previous two steps. We substitute those values of a sub 2 and a sub 3, which we know, and we get the value of a sub 1. So what we have been able to do is we took three equations, three unknowns which were given to us, and we have reduced them into 3, we have reduced them to an upper triangular matrix, the coefficient matrix and upper triangular matrix, done through forward elimination, done the back substitution, and been able to find out what the solution to the 3 equation, 3 unknowns is. And that's the end of this segment.